Hi, welcome. I'm Diana Martin. I'm the Executive Director here at Hourglass, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to today's First Friday Forum on the future of local news with WITF and LNP. If you don't know, actually, this is an area I sort of have a soft spot for. I actually studied journalism in college and spent two summers in college as a staff reporter at Lancaster newspapers. I don't even know if you guys know this. And I really credit that time as very transformative for me personally and just my writing and having great editors, but also in just in developing my love for Lancaster County. At 19 years old, they were sending me off to the intercourse fair. I got to cover shows at the Fulton, go to the Barnstormers. So many of the things that I really love now and appreciate about Lancaster, I really credit that to my time spent at Lancaster newspapers. But that's not why we're here today. We're here because earlier this year, LNP, which is one of the largest newspapers in Pennsylvania, became a subsidiary of WITF after being donated by the Steinman family, who owned and operated Lancaster's daily newspaper for more than 150 years. This comes amidst a changing landscape for media, both nationally and globally. Today, we're going to hear more about the challenges and opportunities that that landscape presents, as well as how the community will benefit from the new Steinman Institute for Civic Engagement that was created through this partnership. Today I'm joined by Bob Krasne, Chairman and CEO of Steinman Communications, Jess King, Executive Director of the Steinman Institute for Civic Engagement, and Ron Hetrick, President and CEO of WITF, for this conversation. So thank you all so much for being here. And oh, you get a pre-round of applause. And after we hear from our presenters, we'll also have time for questions and comments from the audience, so appreciate everyone being a part of this conversation today. Before I hand it over to our speakers, I'd like to thank our First Friday Forum sponsors, Rogers and Associates, for making these forums possible, as well as Millersville University and the Ware Center for hosting us today. I'd also like to thank Shoemaker for providing our live streaming services. So let me hand it over to our guests and look forward to hearing more.
And there you have it. My name is Bob Krasne. Some of you who read LNP letters to the editor may know me as Hale Krasne's husband. But I had the high honor and distinct privilege of chatting with you all at the Hourglass convening in December of 2019. That session was focused on some announcements that were made in conjunction with the 225th anniversary of that august publication. And it came, also at that session, we talked about how the Reading Eagle had just gone into bankruptcy and what that meant for news and information in Berks County. The challenges facing the news industry have only gotten worse since we met that first Friday in December of 2019. But shortly after, and I don't know if we want to go to the next slide.
Mm-hmm. The next one.
There we go. Technology. Yeah. I used to work in the print industry. That explains it all. Shortly after I met with you all in December of 2019, Steinman Communications, which was then the owner of LNP, held a strategic planning session. And at that point, there was some significant conversations about the future of the newspaper and its leadership. And given the fact that the next generation of the Steinman family didn't have anyone with both the aptitude and the interest to lead the newspaper forward, there was some discussion about what should be done. The obvious alternative was a sale. But the one thing that the James Hale Steinman family and the board of Steinman Communications was adamant about was ensuring the long-term vitality of journalism for Lancaster County. And that's reflected not just in their dedication to the newspaper, it was reflected in the fact that the newspaper profits were channeled into the Steinman Foundation, which has given back to Lancaster County more than $110 million in philanthropic gifts. They wanted to ensure that that LNP would have a vital future. And let me give you an example of what a sale could look like. Just today, I read about Alden Media, which is one of the major owners of newspapers across the United States, their activities in San Diego. For those of you keeping track, San Diego is now the eighth largest city in the United States of America. The San Diego newspaper 15 years ago had a newsroom that had roughly 420 journalists. Today, it has a newsroom roughly the size of LNP. LNP, which serves Lancaster County, which is the sixth largest county in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, has a newsroom the size of the newspaper serving the eighth largest city in this country. That gives you a sense of what is going on in the newspaper industry. It is not good. So, with a portfolio of award-winning newspapers, we started looking very seriously at alternatives. But selling to the likes of Alden Media was not an alternative. We really went on a three-year odyssey looking at other prospective media partners, and there were some that at least initially looked promising, but after more careful examination, we realized that they do grave damage to the news organization that we were striving to maintain here for Lancaster County. We also looked at various nonprofit partners. We talked with educational institutions and others. It was a robust and exhaustive evaluation of alternatives. And the leadership decided to approach WITF. And you might ask why WITF? From the perspective of Steinman Communications and the Steinman family. First, they had a self-perpetuating board of directors, which means that its longevity was assured. But more importantly than the self-perpetuating board, the board was comprised of extraordinary talent that really had the capacity and the dedication to the community to husband the resources of an organization like LNP. It also had an innovative leader that in conversations with his peers across the public media landscape was widely respected. And so ultimately, we decided, about a year and a half ago, to reach out and explore whether a combination would make sense. the process that ensued from that point was very deliberate and involved independent third parties that did a host of modeling around business plans, journalism plans, and an array of other issues. But most fundamentally, it all started with a discussion among the leaders of the two organizations to see if there was a strategic vision that could be developed and adopted. And that came together quite easily. And so with that, in April, the announcement was made and the transaction was consummated just after midnight on July 1st. As part of that transaction, just prior to the consummation of it, Steinman Communications converted LNP Media Group, which is the corporate entity, to a B Corp or public benefit corporation under Pennsylvania law.
And will you do the video link, or should I do that here? Just do one more time.
WITF and LNP are thrilled to announce we are bringing our two iconic organizations together and taking a huge leap forward in how we serve our communities. We have always conducted ourselves with integrity, poise, and determination, providing excellence in both journalism and education, and we'll continue doing so at the highest standard. But it's really not about us. It's about you, our friends and neighbors, our coworkers, all of us who call Central Pennsylvania home. By combining our extensive collection of online and traditional media and community programs, we will enhance the lives of all those around us. Rest assured, WITF will continue providing educational support, media literacy, and civic engagement. And LNP will continue providing trusted local news and lifestyle journalism. But together, we will embark on a mission to expand and diversify our media platforms and educational programs. We will focus all our efforts, funding, and expertise on projects that create a positive, lasting impact on the quality of life in our communities. And we will become a magnet for visionary talent who will bring inspired thinking to local news and education. WITF and LNP are more committed than ever to the success of the places where we work, learn, and live. Together, we will work as one to enrich our communities, power local businesses, and inspire all of Central Pennsylvania.
Well, thank you very much, Bob, and it's a pleasure to be here with all of you today. I thought I'd start, I'd ask that the WITF and LNP board members just please stand for a moment and be recognized.
And I'd also like to acknowledge Peggy Steinman, who's here with us today.
It's on the shoulders of board members like those that are here today that really created the framework and the possibility for us to even consider this really wonderful opportunity. And I'd also like to just take a moment to acknowledge the generosity of the family. Really, this is unprecedented in terms of the combination of a local news and public media organization like ours. So let's just take a moment and thank the Steinman family for this wonderful gift they've given Lancaster. All right, so by a show of hands, how many people here subscribe to LNP? Excellent. How many are print only? Okay, it's good to know. how many are WITF members? All right, well, thank you all for being here, because it's with your support that we're able to also continue the work that we're doing. And our model for service moving forward really relies on a robust set of membership and subscribers to help us fund this work going forward. As Bob mentioned, really, we had to make sure that strategically we were aligned with a vision. And I think the line that we came up with that best describes what WITF and LNP represent and the reason why WITF frankly exists is that we believe informed and engaged people build stronger communities. And it's through the tools of WITF and LNP that we're able to help bridge that gap. So when WITF was founded 60 years ago, we were founded to fill an educational gap. One that existed in terms of access to good quality television, educational television, that existed here in Central Pennsylvania. And it's in the spirit of continuing to find those gaps in education and information that we also were very interested in seeing how LNP could help us expand our model of service. So a little bit about WITF. We are based in Harrisburg, although we serve 19 counties. And that includes Lancaster, of course, which is uh, the, largest county in terms of members and audience for WITF, so an alignment with LNP made a whole lot of sense for us to consider. In these 19 counties, we serve over 3 million people. So while the 550,000 folks in Lancaster are a part of that, we do serve over 3 million overall in terms of our catchment as defined by WITF's broadcast area. And that's important to think about because when you think about this model and how unique it is, that's larger than 14 states. Just this 19 counties that are sit here between Pittsburgh and Philadelphia, including Harrisburg, so it's a really, really big area. And the other experimentation that's happening right now at this intersection of public media and local news, they're happening in urban, or mostly urban areas. So the fact that WITF in Lancaster, we have this sort of urban-rural mix is really unique, along with, of course, a very interesting and diverse ideological landscape makes us a very interesting testbed for the kind of work that we're doing. We, of course, are PBS and NPR. That is our member affiliation, although we do like to think of ourselves as local, local, local. That's where we believe our long-term value proposition is to the community. And, of course, Lancaster, LNP and Lancaster Online get us a large step in that direction. We do a lot of education work, and I'll tell you more about that in a moment, and also around civic engagement. Some facts about LNP, ones that you probably mostly know, but they were founded over 230 years ago, and of course, the Steinman family ran LNP for 158 years, correct? Roughly. Located in Lancaster, they are, as Bob mentioned, now a public benefit corp, a subsidiary of WITF. They are indeed the top source of local news, and I can tell you from Jess and I's conversations from around the country that she'll tell you more about, that there is not another another city or metro that they can describe or think of that is like Lancaster County, and in terms of what Lancaster Online and LNP does for the community. As Bob said, having a newsroom that's the size of San Diego's newsroom, we are second only to Philadelphia, and just providing that really in-depth and rich coverage of this community, you know, every municipal meeting, every school board meeting, everything that we do isn't like anywhere else that's happening in the United States. And that's something very special that the family continue to invest in and that we intend to continue to invest in under WITF's ownership. In addition to the local reporting, there also is a really interesting education connection. And I'll talk about how that all sort of comes together here in a moment. So some WITF programs that you may not be familiar with. You know, usually when I'm out speaking to people, they think, oh, NPR, Morning Edition, All Things Considered. They know Tim Lambert. They know the different personalities that we have. But we do a lot of other things. For example, we are the State House reporting hub for Pennsylvania for all the public media stations. So that means if you're listening to WHYY in Philadelphia or WESA in Pittsburgh, you are hearing our reporters. Or if you're on their website, you're seeing our reports. So given that location that we have in Harrisburg, we take that very seriously, that we have the both the obligation and the opportunity to talk about the people, policy, and politics of Pennsylvania to all of our peers throughout the state. We also have a large number of daily, we have a large daily show called The Spark. It used to be called Smart Talk. And if I slip up and call it Smart Talk, you know, please call me out on that. They get angry with me sometimes for doing that. But it's still, you know, sort of Smart Talk at the heart. We have a online digital channel called The Mosaic. So our dive into arts and culture after we you know, moved on from classical music on WITF FM. We do a lot now digitally with The Mosaic. We also have podcasts like The Morning Agenda, Postscript. We have a really awesome podcast called C-Speak, which is supported by PNC that highlights local leaders. And if you saw on LNP's masthead today, Dale High is there, and he was interviewed this week, and it was a really great conversation. You should check out and listen to it. We also have a podcast called The Melanin Report, which is looking at Black and BIPOC communities and the work and the stories that are really interesting and important to them. That's growing very rapidly. It's actually becoming our largest podcast, even beyond The Spark some days, which is really exciting. So we also do a lot in terms of community engagement, and this is something that Jess will build on here in a few moments, but our idea that it's not just us talking about the news and sharing the news that exists in our region. It's about our reporters, our people being out and connected to the community. So doing things like news and brews. And if any of you were in Lititz about 2 weeks ago, we did a very special news and brews between the LNP reporters and the WITF reporters and the community. We had about 60 people there, and we did sort of the speed dating thing, where we had the reporters sit and then visit and talk to different groups of community members. And from that, you know, not only were our reporters better informed about the issues that were important, but they also, you know, we took it back and we shared it with the rest of the crowd, and we also told all of you about it. So you may have seen a story in the last 2 weeks about what we learned from listening to you at News & Brews. So that reflecting back of what we're hearing into the community is really, really important to us. Some of the key takeaways from that were the idea of focusing on local, and like we had said, truly local, not just, you know, this is happening at the State House, but here's what's happening in this neighborhood in Lititz. That kind of local is the kind of news and reporting that people want and they find value in. Focusing on stories of good. Sometimes it can seem really hard with the challenging conversations that can happen in our community around politics to really find the good things, and people want to hear the good things. So a continued emphasis on, again, telling the stories of that are inspiring and helping people find some commonality with each other. Go to the next slide. Oh, you're all right. You're moving me along.
All right.
So next I want to talk about education. And this is something that's really special to us and something that is really important to how we think this model is going to be able to succeed moving forward. So WITF, of course, has always had PBS. We've had PBS Kids. We've done kids events. We just, a few weeks ago, did an event at the Lancaster County Public Library, where we partnered with the Lancaster County STEM Alliance, which is also supported by the Steinman Foundation, to put on a special playdate called Mediate and Makers for caregivers and their children. And that opportunity, that intersection of the ideas that happen in sort of a STEM space of critical reasoning and thinking, we think is really important to helping build young citizens and people who can be good consumers and advocates for news. So there's a connection in terms of the work that we do in the early education space and also to the work that we do around news and information that we try to highlight and build upon. And again, Jess will tell you more about what we're thinking in that area. We also do a lot of things in classrooms where we intend to bring some of this ideas of media literacy and civic education. So the EITC program that many organizations give tax dollars to, we do programs in Lancaster City, York City, and Harrisburg City, again, bringing STEM education or media literacy into classrooms.
since the 1980s, the James Hale Steinman family has been the controlling owner of what is became LNP Media Group. The John Fredericks Steinman family no longer gave up their interest in the newspaper back in the 80s. However, the two Steinman families merged their foundations about a decade ago, and the Steinman Foundation represents both sides of the family. Once the decision was made by Steinman Communications to gift LNP Media Group to WITF, the other side of the family was informed. And that prompted a conversation at the Steinman Foundation board about what could be done to help with that transition. The Steinman Foundation had been focusing for some time on local journalism as an area of their focus. And in fact, the Steinman Foundation's been a member of Media Funders Network, which is a national network of major funders of media, for some time. It was out of those conversations that the board of the Steinman Foundation entered into discussions with WITF that ultimately culminated in a seed grant that was unprecedented in size for the foundation to WITF for the purpose of creating what WITF decided to name the Steinman Institute for Civic Engagement. And for reasons unknown to me, they asked me to chair that board. And the first act that that I undertook in that regard was to reach out to someone I knew who could talk with anybody in Lancaster County about anything, who had deep roots in Lancaster County. And luckily, I was able to persuade Jess King to become the first executive director of the Steinman Institute for Civic Engagement. Jess?
No pressure. Well, it's really nice to see you today. And I honestly, that's what this is about. It's about having conversations with about as many people as we can. And practicing conversations that we're, I think we've gotten out of the habit of having in a lot of ways. So if you want to take away just one thing about the Steinman Institute today, it's really this. It's about how we look at supporting both the supply of local news, but also creating more demand for it. So that's part of the framework for how we're thinking about the Steinman Institute. We could flood the market with as much journalism over and over as possible, but if we don't have folks who want to read it, who see the value in it, who want to consume it, not just reading it, but hearing it, watching it, listening to it, then what good are we actually achieving? So we have to be thinking about demand in a different way. And as Bob talked about, or as Ron talked about, we have been in conversations with folks across the country. This, you know, what Bob was saying about the media landscape right now with what's happening in local journalism isn't just here, it's everywhere across the country, it's international. Since the mid-2000s, we've lost about 2,500 local newspapers. I believe the statistic is about two-thirds, is it two-thirds of counties?
Two-thirds of the counties in this country do not have a daily newspaper.
More than half of journalists that were employed in the mid-2000s were below half that number now. Just thinking about what that means for communities is pretty profound. So we need to be thinking about how we remake a dying news model, honestly, in so many ways. So that's what this is about. It's about supply and demand. And we're talking about doing that through five key pillars. This is really part of the Steinman Foundation gift and thinking about how to get at this in the most strategic way possible. So the supply side is about journalism, supporting the kinds of journalism that LNP is known for. And actually, I'm going to give a shout out to the Local Journalism Fund. Susan Eckert is chairing that effort. And that was really the predecessor in a lot of ways to what the Steinman Institute is doing. And we're talking about ways to work together. But the kind of investments that the Local Journalism Fund has made into LNP to support investigative news, to support, we're talking about how to support things like high school sports, how to support arts and culture, the kinds of things that make people really want to read the news, not just the straight headlines. The other side of that is professional development. And in this industry that's changing so rapidly, how do we make sure that we're continuing to support journalists, creating internships, fellowship opportunities? This is also something that the LNP and LNP Media Group had been doing pretty robustly to the tune of about $700,000 a year for the last number of years to support the professional development of journalists. On the demand side, I'm going to get into this in a little bit more detail, but we're really thinking about this in innovation, education, and civic engagement. So we'll talk about that a little bit more. But first, I actually want to talk, I want to hear from you. You might have seen this in the newspaper this week if you got the hard copy. On Wednesday, it was subscriber appreciation week or day?
Month.
Yes. Month. But this was like a really heartwarming.
They're always appreciative of subscribers.
Indeed.
Everyone should have at least 5 subscriptions.
So on that, before I actually tell you what I think the value of local media is, I actually want to hear what you think. What do you think? And this is just conversational. Feel free to shout it out. What do you value most about local media? And it doesn't have to be just LNP. And you can also be forewarned, I'll give you opportunities to tell us what you want to improve about local media too. It's not just, you know, what you love about it, but what do you appreciate?
What goes on local school districts?
What goes on in local school districts?
Borough, township.
Great. Business and real estate. Say that again? Restaurant inspections. Okay, who has not clicked through one of those headlines on Lancaster Online? Indeed.
I like taking national issues and making them relevant from a local perspective.
Yep. National issues. I'm repeating it just in case people remotely can't hear. National issues and making them local. Liz.
The comics.
The comics. Nice. Great.
I would say coverage of local politics.
Coverage of.
Being from Columbus, there was none.
Okay, great.
So it's really nice to be able. In fact, I borrowed theirs. I was like, I need this.
Whoops.
I need that.
Here we go.
Exactly.
Coverage of local politics. She said she moved from Columbus and they didn't have that there. So really great to hear. Editorials and letters to the editor. And the police log, you want to bring it back, okay. And we've been joking internally that letters to the editor is the original social media, just saying. And, you know, you can see that every day.
The ability for people in our community to actually be in the news and realize that what they're doing is newsworthy.
Ability for folks to see themselves in the news, to be in the news and see what they're doing is worthwhile. That's right. The archives and the historic documentation. Yep.
What's happening in my neighborhood in the future? What's planned to happen that's going to impact me?
Great.
Before it arrives?
So plans for land development or things happening in your neighborhood?
Jack Brubaker in the local history.
The Scribbler. Jack Brubaker. Great. Anyone else want to? These are great, by the way.
Things to do.
Absolutely.
People may not want to admit that they check
these. You know, honestly, that's one of the things I value the most. I mean, how many times do you read the obituaries and see a connection that you know from high school, college, you name it? It's a really valuable community asset.
Local success stories that inspire others to do something similar or even better.
Local success stories.
Why can't I?
That's beautiful. Great. Well, and membership on the editorial board. That's right. So community voices are actually part of that editorial voice. It's not just LNP. Great. Well, thank you, folks. These are the kind of things we want to hear more of. Really appreciate your feedback and your support. And this is the kind of thing that we, that we want to keep hearing from you and hear your ideas about how we take that conversation and expand it, because to create demand, we need way more people having these same feelings about the value of local media. So some of the things that I wanted to just share, obviously, and you've named a lot of these, it maintains core connections, it informs and educates. Local media gives voice to all, especially folks who are underrepresented in media. It promotes the local economy. Real estate listings, local businesses, things to do. It keeps government and elected officials accountable. And I'm going to put on a different hat here. Many of you know that I worked for the city of Lancaster, and you might not know that I oversaw all the communications efforts for the city. So it's fascinating for me to be on this side of the equation now and actually working in some in proximity, although not on the same teams as folks like Jade Campos, who used to cover us from the city perspective. And I just want to say, I think that anyone who is in public service should deeply appreciate the power of local media and value what it can bring. Did I like everything that Dan Neefen or Jade Campos or Tom Lisi or others actually reported about the city or about the mayor? Of course not. But am I grateful for the role of the media and local government? Absolutely. Just this morning, Jade had another article about the Home Rule Study Commission. You might have seen it. And I will say, as having been part of that process to get that conversation going, I think it was largely the kind of reporting that Stim Stoldreyer and that LNP did to elevate the story of the Home Rule Commission is part of the reason it's even underway right now. It's such a wonky idea that even getting it through a ballot measure is, I mean, Burwood can attest to this. You did this back with the county. These are the kind of things that are so, so important, and the value of good government and making sure that people who are in it and in public service are seeing that value. Am I grateful for media's role in elevating policy positions and profiles and campaign finance reports of those who seek to represent us? Absolutely. Think about how valuable that is. Local media, honestly, should be one of the main places where we're having these sort of conversations. And I am so grateful for people who are willing to share their opinions and perspectives in these questions about what do you really think? And if you want to represent our community, representation means saying what you think and standing for defending your position. And that's what we can do in dialogue. That's what we should do in dialogue. So I'll leave that at that. But go back to the list. Local media has the power to connect and unify. It has it is really a critical ingredient in democracy. You may have heard the term the fourth estate. It's really the check and balance in a lot of ways on government. Without it, actually, some statistics I don't have up here. Things like communities that lose their local newspaper actually see their municipal borrowing costs increase. That's like a real data point that comes out of losing local media. You see fewer people running for office, and you actually see increased polarization. MIT did an analysis on this, and you see increased polarization in communities who don't have local media. So what are we gonna do about the Steinman Institute? So I'll talk to you just briefly about this and would love to hear some of your conversation and ideas in the same way that you shared with us about what you appreciate. On the supply side, we want to look at ways of expanding journalism into other places. So Ron explained the 19 county footprint that WITF covers in central Pennsylvania. LNP is the biggest county in that footprint by population and also by WITF member size. We have such an opportunity to expand the kind of things that we're doing in Lancaster and some of those other markets. So having conversations about what we're doing here with those, every public meeting, every school board meeting that we cover in Lancaster County, and that's a lot. I don't know the number.
Too many.
But that kind of thing is not happening in the same communities across the footprint in the same way. So looking at ways to expand that. Looking at ways of going into news deserts, so to speak, where a community or a county may not even have a local publication, even a digital publication. So opportunity to lean into that and be strategic about ways we can expand into some of those new markets. We're talking about ways of expanding the support of bringing more journalists online. Just this morning, we were having a conversation about ways to work with colleges in the WITF footprint to really lean into journalism programs and building more relationships between our reporters and college newspapers and college students who want to get into this space. Also high school students. Had some great conversations with McCaskey, wanting to see the students there connect with journalists and getting their work elevated, possibly for publication. You see some of that already in LNP. We want to do more of that. On the innovation side, this is about new products, new services, but it's also about new ways of thinking about data or getting access to things. So one of the things we're in conversation about and already doing, actually, is the digitization of all the paper campaign finance records at the local level. You may or may not know that if you want to see what candidates for office at the county level, at the city level, mayor, council, school board, township supervisor, if you want to see what they raised for their campaigns, which by the way, in Pennsylvania, there are no campaign finance limits, and there's also no limits on the types of entities who can give. So there's a real opportunity for that to not actually represent our interests as a community. So one of the things that we're doing is called the data desk and scanning in all of those campaign finance records to make them publicly accessible, publicly available, so you don't have to go dig through literal filing cabinets to find that information. That's one example of an innovation that we're exploring. On the education side, in addition to what we talked about with high school and colleges, we're talking about media literacy. These are things in such a changing landscape. I mean, I know I have a 14-year-old and an 18-year-old, and I am alarmed with the level of access to information that they can get on resources like TikTok and YouTube, and how to make sure our kids understand how to know truth from fiction and critical thinking skills, and honestly, how some of us need to learn more about that, right? That isn't just for our kids. So I also can imagine a future where our kids are creating some of that content to share more broadly, even on our channels, to talk about how to tell truth from fiction. On the engagement side, I think this is about telling our stories in new and different ways, having the community reflected back to itself, connecting across differences. Maybe you heard, I was just listening to NPR this morning and the StoryCorps program of folks, the One Small Step effort, where you take folks who are across political and ideological polar opposites, having a conversation to find out what they actually have in common. And elevating that conversation, not just the ones about what we don't have in common or why we think we're so different. Let's do more of that. let's have more of those conversations to actually see who we are as a community and what we have in common. Let's do more deliberative democracy, like Dr. Medvick and Dr. Yost have been doing up at FNM. And if you were here last month for the Hourglass, they talked about what that looks like. But imagine more of that deliberative democracy as a tool to practice disagreeing together, to practice talking to each other, and actually to practice finding solutions to things like policy and making those recommendations back to our public officials. Those are just a few top line thoughts at this stage. We are just getting started. We're gonna be doing quite a bit more to learn what you all want and need. And I didn't have it soon enough to include it in here, but we're launching a survey today to a broader group in this 19 county footprint, but also to WITF and LNP subscribers. Really encourage you to take that survey to understand a little bit more about wants and needs and preferences on local media, but also to understand getting a baseline of civic engagement right now so that we can look at how to change that and measure if what we're doing is actually influencing it in any way. So we'll send that link out through Diana, so you can take that survey. And love to hear you share your ideas and contribute to the development of the Steinman Institute for Civic Engagement, because it's really only going to succeed if we have help in building it. So I would like to take the next little while, we have at least 15 minutes left, to ask a few more questions of you. And you can also, in turn, ask questions of us as part of the Q&A. Maybe treat this as one. Where feel free to tell us what you'd like to see more of in local media. If you think there are stories that are not.
This is a secret ploy to just get more attention on our sponsors, Robert.
Well done.
Are there stories we're not telling or that you think we should tell? Or do you have questions for us? So let's just turn it into that conversation.
And before we do, there's one thing I'd like to really emphasize that is very unique about this combination. Since we entered into, Steinman Communications entered into conversations with WITF about this arrangement, there have been a couple other announcements of combinations of newspapers and public media outlets. But what makes this combination unique is the work of the Steinman Institute to try to understand how to make media really work. And looking at not just supplying more content, but also understanding what drives demand for that content. Earlier this week, I read a survey that came out from the Pew Foundation that was horrifying. Let me share it with you. In 2016, 51% of the American public said they followed the news all or most of the time. That was 51%. In 2022, that number dropped to 38%. Even more shocking than that is in 2022, that part of the survey that reached people between the ages of 18 and 30, 19% said they followed the news all or part of the time. Or put another way, 81% of people under the age of 30 don't follow the news. And just to give you an example of the importance of local news from a admittedly parochial perspective, in today's newspaper, there was an article about the police coalition panning a flyer. It's this flyer. And the flyer simply states, backed by law enforcement. But the local newspaper asked local law enforcement, and several heads of fraternal orders of police said, no, we don't endorse. So who was the endorsement from? It was from the elected sheriff, who happened to be of the same party of the people who were being endorsed. Now, I know some people like to degrade the newspaper and say that it's an organ of the Democratic Party or working part and parcel with it. Really what the newspaper is an organ that really strives to highlight the truth. And in civilized society, the truth isn't political. The truth, or the best available version of the facts, as Carl Bernstein referred to it, is something that needs to be reported in a dispassionate fashion. And I venture to guess that everybody in this room has a pretty good sense of the difference between a section of the newspaper that has, at the very top, I think, it says opinions, to understand that's an opinion section. And the rest of it, the facts are the facts in the sports section. You know, there's usually not much dispute about the scores that are reported. The same is true with the A section. So the effort to degrade or debase the newspaper by some folks, some leaders, is what feeds into the results that we see from the Pew survey. And why do they behave that way? The only logical conclusion is because they'd like to do away with the watchdog, that the function that the newspaper serves. Sorry.
Thank you. Let's do a round of applause for our speakers. Well, we do have some time for thoughts and questions from the audience. I'll start here with you, John.
Hi, just for record, John Trescott, County Commissioner. And I just want to follow up on Bob's statement. Over the last 2 years I've been County Commissioner, I did watch my two fellow commissioners go out of their way to denigrate the paper at any opportunity they could. And when I would ask them, well, if you're not reading from the paper, where are you getting your news? And there was no response. But I do believe it is, from at least some groups, a concentrated effort to make sure that there is no watchdog.
Questions, opportunities, back to Jess's question as well.
I'm going to answer both questions. The first question is, what would you like to see more of? And let me state for the record that I'm a strong fan of LNP and of the kind of journalism that they do. But I would like to see a little bit more of the fact-checking that occurs when the newspaper does make an error, and they occasionally do make an error. And what you see is a little correction thing that's on the inside of the first page that's not very large. So I'm not sure what the answer to that is, but I'd like to see a little bit more of that. And then the second answer to my question is exactly what Bob just said, so I don't need to talk anymore.
Here, raise your hand high if you have a question or thought.
Thank you for coming today. Great presentation. Thank you for the contribution to your community and the commitment to our community. Jess, I think you all kind of touched on it. The game really seems to be the fact that a college senior who's graduating in May probably has never touched a newspaper, literally. And that's the audience. That's who we need to start thinking about. How do you approach that? How do you get them engaged and change that? I think the number was 39% back up to the 51 or even greater, where they're interested in the news and they can easily absorb it and consume it.
I don't know that we have the answer right here, but that's what we're trying to solve. Indeed. And honestly, having them help create some of the answers, having them be part of the creation of it, I think is one way. To have them see themselves in it is partly how we get there. And embed teaching opportunities with actual product for them to help create content.
And I can give you an example. Just this week, we have a small team of people out in Cumberland County, which is one of the growing news deserts that Jess alluded to. And we actually had five different video clips that were created around local news. So they were explainers of different things like Three Mile Island and other things that are happening in the news. And we were using that and testing that with them, both in terms of format and story, to see if it resonated. Again, meeting people where they're at on the platforms that they're using is key to that. Mm-hmm. We learned a lot. I've not seen the full report yet, but again, we need to be better about connecting with those younger audiences and you know, helping to buck the trend that Bob described. We do, but not well. Yeah. You know, it's a growing area for us. We need younger people who are there using those platforms that are telling those stories in the voices of the people that are consuming it.
You know, an old guy like me remembers a guy like Tip O'Neill who famously said, all politics are local. Yeah. That has fundamentally changed in society today because for a couple of reasons. One is the internet. And the other is the elimination of the fairness doctrine and the equal time doctrine. So that's allowed the creation of Fox News and MSNBC, which are politicized and polarized by and large. It is opinion news as opposed to news. We've been in conversations internally about ways to try to help provide more information that is very granular at the township, at the municipal level, which in Lord knows we have lots of municipalities, so there's a lot that can be done. But in trying to think about developing a citizen reporting corps to have people actually engaged in the creation of news as well as the consumption of news in an effort to make it a widespread community effort.
Other thoughts, opportunities, questions?
It goes back to Socrates, who said that the written word is dangerous because you're only getting one side. That to get the truth requires debate. One against the other, and the problem with the written word, maybe opinion sections, is you're getting one side, and you don't have somebody against the other side. So you get the old newspapers used to have the morning was Democrat.
Art, with all due respect, that's not always true. And I say this as a reader of the newspaper because mm-hmm. I'm no longer publisher. Just last week in the opinion page, there was a discussion of the controversial legislation in Harrisburg with regard to procedures for determining what books would be available or not available in schools. Yeah, Senator Aumit made his presentation, and beside it was the other. So you heard both sides represented.
Yeah, I'm not saying you're not doing it. I'm saying it's a practice that needs to be kept and enhanced. And maybe the opinion section ought to be maybe a little color, like an off gray, so people know that this is not news, this is just people writing in what they're thinking.
Because the other side of opinion is, no, that's, they think it's fact.
Right? That's right.
Okay, that came from the off gray section of the commentary. Any other questions or thoughts for our speakers? We have one right here.
Jess, I don't know if you know whether the schools have a program. And when I was in school, the history teacher actually used the newspaper to teach from. And it built a habit in all of us to turn to the newspaper for what we needed to know. I don't know if there's a program like that in the school district where maybe we could encourage some of the teachers to actually use the newspaper and
Absolutely.
Point out how valuable it is?
It's not universal to my knowledge, but actually I think even in this, I think one of the things in that clipping was every morning my class, or I use this to teach in my class. Mm-hmm. And so there are teachers who use it now, today, in Lancaster County, and I believe we have subscriptions delivered to every school. I feel like almost every day there are papers in the school that we get there. I need to verify that. But
to every barbershop.
To every barbershop? That's a good idea. Yeah. But to your point, yes, how we do that more consistently. One of the things that we're looking into is to try to get a better understanding of the baseline of civics education and specifically media literacy in Lancaster County to start. We're thinking about this whole exercise as a bit, Lancaster is a bit of a laboratory for how we practice some of these ideas. So looking in Lancaster first, but then looking elsewhere and seeing where are there gaps in how, again, because of the changing media landscape, how can we help address those gaps strategically and really provide value to educators and families?
The only other comment I would have is that the newspaper is so critical to the well-being of our community. With AI coming to do its wonderful things to our news, the critical need in the newspaper, and I don't know how a newspaper goes about this, whether they run a truth or fiction column, or there has to be the newspaper should be able to help people think through what is truth and what is not truth. And that can apply to our politicians, but it can also apply to all the other subjects that you run.
Mike, did I see your? See how quickly I can run without knocking anything over.
Well, first of all, great presentation. Thank you to Hourglass, and thank you to the three speakers. You did a terrific job. When I was in the General Assembly, I was in the State Senate for Northern Lancaster County for 8 years. When I first went in, I was told, be careful what you say, because you will get the news clips of your name across the entire Commonwealth the next morning. And sure enough, somebody, some staffer would clip news clips for every member and put those news clips on your desk anytime you are referenced or anytime your committee was referenced, and it definitely had an impact in what you said and how you said, at least for most members. As far as the people following the news going from 51% down to 38%, that's staggering. But what I hear over and over and over again is people have higher anxiety levels, higher stress levels, to the point of some serious mental health related issues. And some professionals are pointing to the media as a result of that. And it's not the way the media reports the news, it's the way society is conducting itself, and it's scary. I don't have the answer, but I hear frequently people offering opinions to other people, turn the news off, stop reading the paper, because all it does is just raise your anxiety level. Again, it's not the way the reporters are reporting, it's just the fact that they're reporting on what's really happening, and it's not good.
Yeah. That's a great comment, Mike. I think the interesting aspect of that is to try to deconstruct your definition of news or media. Folks who watch Fox News or MSNBC have higher anxiety. When you look at a bucolic picture on A1 of the newspaper, it's not the same. Are pummeled if they're on Facebook or Twitter or TikTok or social media for a couple reasons. One is all those internet providers have statutory immunity for what's posted on their sites. In other words, they have no liability for garbage that's posted on their sites. Whereas if something's posted on Lancaster Online, Mr. Hetrick here is going to have to do a lot of explaining to his board and the insurance carriers, and it's going to become a major problem. So there's tremendous care given to what's posted on Lancaster Online, a big distinction. Further, the whole notion of using amplification so that the things that are most controversial, craziest, are amplified algorithmically to ensure that they're the things that are most seen. So it's social media and the national media that really, I think, are the foundations for the problems that you've identified quite properly. How to deal with them, I fear, is beyond the scope of our assignment. But it's a very real challenge for society today, mm-hmm. which is why this is an initiative to redouble the focus on local media. You read the letters to the editor in LNP. the number of letters about the border, you know, the Texas-Mexican border, you'd make you think we live in El Paso. You know, and certainly, you know, immigration is a concern, and there, you know, there's a lot of blame to go around for a lack of comprehensive immigration legislation, and the need for workers in immigration. The policy wonks can talk about that for a long time, and there's a lot that Congress and the executive branch can do together. But we need to focus on what we have within our control here in Lancaster County, and trying to find, through solutions-based journalism, answers to those, and determine the best path forward to make the county we all live in and love, you know, even better tomorrow than it is today, is really the task of local journalism, and something that I think the Steinman Institute and WITF and LNP together can help forward.
Thank you. I think we're out of time for questions. So yeah, let's give a round of applause for all of our speakers. Thank you so much for joining us and sharing all about the exciting partnership. I think all of us in this room know the value of local news. So really wishing you success and interested to keep engaged with how your work progresses. Our next First Friday Forum will be back here on Friday, December 1st. We'll be hearing from leaders at Willow Valley Communities about their planned memory care center and how it will serve not just their residents, but the community at large that's affected by dementia. So that's a topic that's increasingly important as our county continues to age, and we're gonna tackle that topic next month. So I hope that you can join us back here. If you would like to get invited to that forum and future forums, please become an Hourglass member. You can do that on our website at hourglasslancaster.org. It's also, I will let you get out of the room, but it's also the time of year where I have to remind people that we are raising funds for all of our programming and the education that we do in the community. So if you're donating on Extraordinary Give on November 17th, please consider Hourglass or consider us with your end of year giving. We're a small organization, so all of your gifts go a big way. So thank you so much, and thank you to all of our members who are here today.